start then with public comment on any items in the agenda for the Finance Committee meeting. Okay. Wait till everybody gets logged in here. Everybody ready? Okay. So I'm going to welcome Mr. Dauber to our meeting tonight, his first committee meeting. So the first item on the agenda is the Plancon bonds, so I'll let him explain that. He can do a better job than I can, so.
Okay, this is the 2015 bond issue. What Plancon K is documentation. It goes to the state to tell them that the Penn Ridge School District refinanced the bond issue, and it's the state will then assign that particular new bond issue a reimbursement rate, and they will close the bond issue that we refinanced. So all this is just the last step in the refinancing, send the documents to the Department of Education, and then they will finish up the new bond issue.
Are these ones we did this spring?
Yes.
Okay, so is there any questions on those? You can read them. Good luck if you figure them out. But so I guess is that something we have to approve then for the board meeting? Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. For the regular meeting. Okay. All right. The next item on the agenda is our list of contracts. We have A through K. Items A and B are for the what was just discussed at the curriculum committee meeting, the infrastructure license agreement and the LinkedIn license agreement. So obviously they will be up for approval when we also, at that board meeting, when we also, if we agree to purchase the software. Is there any questions on those?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
On the agenda, it has, under the link, a $59,132 cost, but on the handout, it's $54,732. Which one's correct?
Oh, we don't know.
$54,732.
Let me just add that the contract itself that I reviewed features a purchase price of $59,132. So we'll need to adjust that as well.
Okay. We'll take a look at it tomorrow, make sure that it's correct.
The one attached to the curriculum committee agenda has the $59,132. So.
What's the correct spelling of that infrastructure? You have two different spellings.
L-I-N-K-I-T.
Infrastructure. That's the one you're talking about?
Yeah, you have one on the agenda and one on the on your board agenda.
The agenda in front of me. Just spell it.
Well, we're not going to approve it tonight anyway, so I believe it. Yes, this one says infrastructure, but I think it's supposed to be infrastructure.
So we're pulling the infrastructure from the agenda as well?
Yeah, I think we should just pull both of them.
Yeah, I don't see why we have anything that we discuss always right before we have a committee meeting, and then there's time before the board meeting.
Correct.
I don't see, there's other things on here too on the board agenda that.
Okay, the next contract is for a student. Item D is a author visit. I believe that person has been here before. I don't know that name. Items E and F are the IU not sure, did anybody have any questions on either one of those, E or F?
They don't know what they're voting on.
Yes, I have a question. Item F has to do with the ombudsman program. And that has been one that has been under some criticism over the years. I wondered if we have decided at this point that we are happy with that program, or whether we're still somewhat dissatisfied.
I think there are mixed reviews on that, but what I will tell you, Dr. Yurnell, is we have cut our slots in half. In the past, we were asked to purchase so many, whether we use them or not. And Dr. Phillips, in working with this group, has agreed with them that we can cut it down in half, so that's why it's a significantly lower number, although we do use this program. There are not a lot of options right now that we need in this regard, but that is one that we do use.
Okay. Any other questions? Item G, Council of Southeast Pennsylvania. Any questions on that one? Is that something we've used before, or is that, do you know?
Yes, it is.
Dr. Phillips put that on, but as far as I understand, the Council of Southeastern Pennsylvania trains student assistant teams in schools.
Okay. Like emotional needs or
education? SAT
teams.
Student assistant teams in schools, and they do come out for drug and alcohol, behavior, social.
That's what I thought. I wasn't sure.
Okay.
You are.
Yeah.
Thank you,
item H is our engagement letter for our upcoming board. I believe, if you remember, last year we did an RFP for auditor services, and we picked Mally for 3 years. So this, and I did recheck, this was the fee that they quoted us. So.
I think my thoughts were wrong.
The next item is for Quest, said Quest Tech, which I believe we've used before also. Any questions on that one?
Yeah, so what do they use them for?
For the same thing, I believe, for on-site desktop and help desk support.
Yes, the addendum to that contract that we have from previous years is adding a database assistant to assist that again. So we contracted with Questech. We found an individual that's very qualified. We provided the contract to the solicitor, and now it's for your approval, for you to review, and we're seeking approval for next week's board meeting. Any questions?
So can you explain what they do?
Okay, so Diane Miller, our database manager, because of the added duties that in the past couple months we added, we felt that it's necessary to have a person that can assist her with other duties. She today is, you know, working 40 hours. I had never seen her work 40 hours for about a year now, and so we felt that we needed to add another person. I spoke then with Kathy Johnson about this several months ago, and we felt that because we were not 100% sure that we needed a full-time person that will cost us extra cost, that we would contract a person for a year and see how it goes, and then we can propose for in the future to either add another person, or if we don't have the need, we don't do it because it's only a year contract. The cost of the person is the salary plus the taxes So the cost, what we save from that is the insurance and the healthcare and all the other benefits.
Are we committing full-time for this person?
This person will be full-time, will be 40 hours, just like our other person that we contract through them. 40 hours. However, Matt works more than 40 hours, I would say that. Matt is a young man, technical, that he's really good, and we believe that after our third-year contract, we have two more years, that perhaps we bring him on board, and then we'll make that decision then, or that recommendation at that point.
But you think you need a full-time person?
Absolutely, absolutely. See, a lot of the items that Diane, the added, so let's talk about Diane today without even the added duties. Today, she has items that just sit in the back, and we can't be proactive with our data. She takes care of PIMS, Power School, our logins. Our data is always on time to the state. She has been very instrumental in cleansing our data for Power School and the state. So there's a lot of projects that we need Diane to work on. For example, HR. We have some items that we would like to work on HR. The curriculum office has some items for her as well. So we need another person. We in our department, as you know, we run really lean. We run really a tight shift, if you will. So we could not, we thought of, okay, maybe who can pick up the slack? And it was just, it was overwhelming, actually, when we thought about it.
We recently changed Diane Miller's job description, which I don't know if the board has approved that or not. Dr. Schreiner, that we talked about that.
Right, I believe that was approved already.
It's 20,
okay, so
27.
Some of the things that she used to do, she's not doing now.
27, that goes to the 27.
So that's why there's a hole in this department. What Mr. Gerardo said, and money was in your budget, I believe. For
yes, this money was budgeted. We shifted around some items, and we put it in the budget. And we did talk about it early on. However, we did not talk about it in length like we did now. Now we are here. It's time for the position to become available. So that's why we're bringing that up.
This particular contract that's in front of us has a non-compete, non-solicitation clause.
Yes.
I assume the one that you're talking about previously does not have that.
It does. However, the company is from Pittsburgh. We've been in conversation with them about that same topic. We have raised that question. We don't think that, you know, 3 years, 2 years from now, at the time comes, let's say that Matt, you know, we want to bring him on board. At that point, we will talk to them and see what arrangement we can make. They, you know, it's on the contract. Mr. Cox has seen the contract. He has made changes to the contract. And we respect that the non-compete. We do. So when the time comes, I would recommend that we look at it and we try to work with them. And by the way, if at the time, if it doesn't fit our budget, we will continue having the young man as a contract. He really enjoys being at Penn Ridge. He has not expressed at this time to become an employee of Penn Ridge, but he just really likes working and learning and doing everything that he does for us. So it's something that we are aware of.
My view of the non-compete was that although it's not obviously favorable to the district because it reduces the district's flexibility. It's not uncommon for that kind of provision to appear in an agreement like this where a school district or some other organization is receiving a highly skilled form of labor. I did make a couple of changes to this agreement which don't seem to appear on the one that's on the agenda. And that probably is because it just crossed with when this went up for the board to review. The most important of which, though, was a termination for convenience provision, which I believe I added to the Questech agreement from the prior term and added to this one. If nothing else gets into the agreement with respect to my changes but that one change, that would be the one. If the district can get out of this agreement and most agreements on relatively short notice, 30 days or 60 days, it substantially reduces the risk of these types of agreements because the district can cut its losses. So I'm sure this individual will do an excellent job, and I don't mean to suggest otherwise, but that one provision, the termination for convenience provision, in this and similar agreements is important. So that'd be my main suggestion.
How do we know who is this person, and so, how do we know they're going to do an excellent job? And then I'm going to answer that.
Okay, so the way it works is that the company puts, we talked to the company a couple months ago, and we told them what we're looking for. We told them what we believe this person's duties is going to entail, and they put together an announcement. They posted the announcement on their website, on Monster, I believe, in some local newspapers around here, because we need a person that is local. Out of that, we interviewed three individuals. And this particular individual that we would like to bring on, it's a person that's been in the data side of technology for many years. He comes with a lot of background that we can use and tap into him right away. So we want to keep him. See, the thing is, when we bring him on and we want to make him feel at home, and we want him to stay here at Penn Ridge. The contract, if one of these people that we hire, they leave, they find us another person. It already happened once. So we do the interviewing, we do the vetting of the they do theirs, and then we do ours. We check their clearances, just like an employee. But they're employees. So if the person that we're looking at, if he decides 3 months from now to move on, well, then they have to find another person. And we don't pay during that lapse.
This is only a 50-week contract, it's not a whole year, but then it says they get vacation days and then all the other days up, because at first when I saw it was 50 weeks instead of 52,
right.
You think, okay, well they get 2 weeks.
I think it's because they get the 2-week vacation.
No, but it says in here they get Questec holidays, they get vacation days earned by the Questec employee, and then they get their sick and personal days, and then they get days off as well when the building's closed, when the building's inaccessible.
I will check the 50 weeks. I read that. One other thing is that the other issue with the 50 week is because this is going to start the first week of August, the 28th of June. So I wonder if that's the case, but I will find that out because they knew from the beginning that this contract would not just start July 1st, that it will start July 28th.
Yeah, and it says it ends July 16th. I don't know, there's just something that doesn't seem right about this to me. Like, we don't, like, we're hiring somebody, but we never knew it, and I don't know, here it is. It's odd.
When you say it's odd, you don't think we need the position, or?
I don't know, we haven't gotten any justification for it. And then he said something like, Diane, you've never seen Diane, was that her name, Diane, worked 40 hours, and now she's working 40 hours. Well, that doesn't make sense to me either.
I think what David was saying, Diane works many more than 40
hours. 60, 70 hours. So I'm sorry, I am sorry if I miscommunicated that. This has been going on, her hours, for about a year, year and a half, and we've been trying to get her to just work 40 hours or 45, but she does work long hours, and that's why we felt that the position was necessary. And I apologize if that came across incorrectly.
And I should point out some of the responsibilities Diane is now going to have with Dr. Shai, because of the skills that she does have with assessments and things of that sort, she's being transferred to some of the new responsibilities of that department, which is why there's a void in David's area.
I would just expect if we're hiring another person that there'd be some background about why we need this person. Here's just this contract, and it's just appeared with no background as to why it's here.
It's not the first year, though, is it?
No. So we've hired somebody?
Person, but it just... This is... We already... through this company, we are help desk. We use our, the help desk comes from them. We have a person that has been with us a year on this position. And so we have had a relationship now with them for over about a year and a half.
But this is still an additional position.
We are, as we're seeking an additional position, so that is correct.
Yeah, it is an additional position.
Oh, an additional.
Yes. It's the same company we've used, but they're going to fill another position.
Oh, okay, I wasn't getting that either.
Mrs. Yardley, if a decision brief would help explaining background, current status, and rationale for recommendation, we'd be glad to do that.
Yeah, because honestly, that was all confusing now that it's all been separated out. I misunderstood everything.
She never uses her microphone.
I think it was very confusing. I think there was, and I think it seems like everyone has a question. I feel like it's like this veiled answer, like it's code or something that I'm not, I don't get it.
And I think, too, because we're in a period of transition here, that's why, you know, maybe a little bit of confusion, but we will get a decision brief to you on this. Valid point.
It's already, I have it and I will be providing that to you in the next couple of days. Any other question? Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so we will wait for that and then we'll decide if this stays on for the July meeting. Okay, the last, J is once again another, it's Lakeside Educational, which we've used before, I believe, for a service, educational services for Dr. Phillips. And then Blackboard Connect, I believe that that's our current software, right, for the email. So.
I have a question about the Blackboard Connect. Is this, how many years have we used it? Because we used to have a different system, and I'm wondering why we switched, when we switched.
We did not switch, the company changed names.
Oh, they changed names, okay.
I think you could have explained.
So that's it for the contracts. Item three, I believe, are purchase orders for three of them are for laptops, middle school laptops, 62,550, elementary school laptops, 145,950, and high school or laptops, $44,477.76. I believe we did discuss all these in prior meeting. The actual purchase. So these are just the actual purchase orders to approve. So I believe those are on the agenda for tonight, right? Does anybody have any questions on those? And then D is some kind of ZBrush clothing licenses for a part. So
the first time.
Did that come under
your program program improvement.
Okay. Item four is an agreement between us and the Upper Bucks Technical School. I don't know if anybody wants to talk about that one.
As I understand, this is a an agreement that has been talked about with the board prior to tonight. This is where our food service director here at Penridge is going to provide food service director services to management services to the Upper Bucks Technical School to try to help that program succeed.
Yes, basically, the vocational technical school's cafeteria program and lunch program has struggled and basically lost money year after year without much respite. So the hope is that Mrs. Giantara can provide some guidance in making that a more successful program, both in terms of student want to eat there and in terms of the cost and balance sheet structure of that particular program, because it is intended to be a standalone and a break even at least. Remmon has not been for a number of years.
Are there any other questions on that agreement? Okay. Item five is, I believe, just a request to conduct an RFP for art appraisal services.
This is an item that Dr. Radigan had requested that we take a look at. We have apparently a large volume of art throughout the district, and the hope was to find someone who would give us a somewhat accurate value of that art throughout the district, and then the board can decide what they wish to do with it.
I was also concerned with the storage and if it's being stored properly to avoid deterioration. So is that some way we can get that worked in there? Also, while we're on that note, I did a tour of the VOTEC and the construction, and some of the walls are very bare, and I wondered if we could maybe share some of this art temporarily, if that's possible. I didn't talk to Bird about that. But I don't know if that was an option. Why wasn't thinking about it? Instead of burying it in a storage.
Okay. All right. So we will then approve the request then for the RFP to go out. Yeah. Item six. Apparently, the Silverdale Borough current tax collector, I guess, has moved out of the district, so they are asking us to approve the appointment of the new tax collector. So that's something we have to put on the agenda. That actually, we'll do that tonight, I believe.
Yes, please.
Yes. And then item seven, we have quite a few student activity accounts. All except two are renewals for the upcoming school year, and there's two new ones, the SAD Club and the Ski and Snowboard Club. So any questions about any of this?
Yeah, I'm wondering about the Ski and Snowboard Club, since we just approved them going on a trip, and they've done, I mean, they've been around for years. Why is this a new account and not a renewal?
They used to have one.
Every year to the course?
No,
not every year. For some reasons,
this
account
closed. Yeah, they closed.
And why?
Why are they?
Can you speak into the microphone, please?
I cannot explain why, but this account was closed and involved, actually. I can find the date when
this account was closed. Yeah, I'm just curious because they.
Actually, it was close, I believe, when we had Mr. Creeden, Dr. Creeden is a is a principal, and they started to reopen accounts now.
Okay, yeah, I would like some background about it.
I can find it.
Yeah, and if it was closed, how did they collect their money?
So,
and the general services account.
Okay, so we'll get that information. Is there any other one of these that anybody else have questions on?
I do.
Mr. Sarnese, I just wanted to make one comment on an issue that came up. I think either in public comment at the beginning of this meeting or in public comment at the end of the last one, I'm not sure which, but Ms. Furlong brought up a point with respect to bidding software that I wanted to speak to. She also made a distinction between sales tax applicable to a service versus sales tax applicable to a supply. I'm not sure I agree with her on that, although I'll speak to Mr. Prior to the board's vote on it. But it is my view that a professional service like the professional expertise you get when purchasing software and then also purchasing the expertise and service that goes along with maintaining and supporting that software is something on balance that falls outside the standard public bidding requirements. And I compare it to legal services in the following sense. A lot of times you're purchasing a brief or some kind of legal document and you're purchasing legal services. But you're still, even though there's a product that results from that, you're still purchasing a professional service. And I think that logic would apply to the purchase of software as well. So,
it doesn't. It doesn't.
With respect to the point Ms. Furlong made, I wanted to address it and offer my two cents. And while I'm always prepared to be educated on an issue by Ms. Furlong or any member of the public or any other person, I'm not sure that I share her view of a distinction between supplies and services from that sales tax perspective. I'll speak to Mr. Tony about that after. That's all I have.
Okay, that completes the finance part. I'm going to just move right into the facilities. Mr. Casper isn't here tonight, so I'm just going to keep going on this, and because there's not too much in this part. So I guess, Lockwood, you're going to handle the first item for the capital improvements.
Where's that?
Well, we have Mr. Spadafore here tonight to go over our capital improvements.
This is the facilities meeting?
Do we have a handout for this?
No, we're just giving an update.
Okay.
I just wanted to keep the board apprised of the progress that's going on with the four projects that we have out this summer. One is the boiler replacement at the operations building, which is ongoing. The only one not affected by June and July's constant wet weather. The roof on that same building is ongoing. That one, it was a very short project. They're actually almost wrapping that up, so that one will not be an issue. We also have the roof coating at Central Middle School. They have performed the replacement of some of the wet insulation that they did find, and the initial coating is going down. However, we do need to have a 30-day cure period, and this rain is holding that curing process up a bit. Now, this isn't a typical roof replacement, so it won't cause us any real inconvenience. When kids come back, we can still schedule that after hours on weekends if it goes beyond that date. We're not worried about it yet, but the wet weather is not working in our favor. Similar to the stadium improvements, in the next couple weeks, you will see what looks like a building rather than a pile of dirt. It's kind of all kind of culminated to this. The weather is not cooperating there either. We are moving along. At this time, we don't think we'll have more than about a week delay, which normally is like our punch list period anyway. So at this point, we don't see any issues with opening, but we are keeping an eye on the schedule and the weather. If anything with that changes, we will come back to the board and keep everyone advised of what our progress is. But all's well for now. State of the union, Jess.
State of the stadium.
This must be hell on the construction.
Any questions for either one of them on any of them? Okay. The second item. Do you want to talk about that?
So in speaking of the field house, as we developed the plans, went out to bid, and started the project, we were looking at how this is going to be used and how often it's going to be used, who's going to be allowed in it, when it's going to be open. And we met with administration, we met with David Babb, we met with food service and the high school principal on the availability. And the more we met, the more we realized that this is going to be used every day, quite often, all day long. So with that, we needed to clean it. And at this point, I think we're all in agreement that we're going to be looking for a four-hour position dedicated to the stadium. It'd be like a 6 a.m. Start time. So we clean it in the morning, it's come around 8 or 9 o'clock. It'll be used till evening time, 9:30. So the cleaning time would be in the morning. And it does look like it'll be 5 days a week. So we're developing a job description for that, which will really be a template of the custodial duties already. We're just adding some line items that have to do more with the stadium. and the responsibilities.
They just keep hiring people and not having people.
I guess I missed some discussion about this. I wasn't sure that we were even going to be providing HVAC for this building or whether it was going to be used all winter. Obviously, that's progressed dramatically since that time, but the belief to be able to be used full-time now, is that the focus?
Yes, there is no air conditioning, there's heating only, and it will be used year-round, probably a little less come January. In the job description for the four-hour position, you would also then just come down to the high school, or we could lower those hours to 3 hours a day. So there's plenty of work in the high school that needs also. So if there's any downtime, that's where you go down.
I'm wondering why this is on a facilities agenda, not on personnel.
The reason is due to the time frame. We met, actually, I was at a meeting before I actually started here for Dr. Radick and Kathy Johnson and Jeff, the AD, and a few other people. We discussed the need for this position, and in order to have this person there up and running and ready to work by the time school opens and we have the facility for the first football game, we were hoping to put it on this agenda and get it through the board so that we have time to hire. Because we're running into a tight window. It's the middle of July.
Do we have a cost attached to this?
Yes, the cost estimate that I have for a 4 hour a day person for a full year is for wages and wage fringe benefits is $25,200.
And fringe is pension through health care or anything?
Actually,
do they get intangible?
They would be eligible at proration of fringe benefits if they do choose them.
So this is inclusive?
No, that is not. It could be if someone, we hired someone and they chose the family plan, at the highest potential cost would be about $11,000 more for those. But
so it would be $36,000 for the stadium?
Yeah, if the person chose benefits. But they would have about half the cost of the.
Maybe we can fundraise.
Has this been budgeted?
This particular position has not been budgeted, so we're going to have to find some funds within the budget and transfer. And if Jeff is aware of that, then we'll work on it.
Just add a small piece of that. We budget every summer for 6 students development, and we only had 4 apply this year. Hired 4, 3 started, one has not. We're only working with 2 now. Small piece of the puzzle, but there is money left over from our 6 student helpers that ended up just being 2 this summer. So there's a little bit of money available there.
And this is permanent. Mr. Loeffler, I think we also talked about the fact that by having this available every month of the year, then we can even have outside groups using it, and that will bring in some income as well, some revenue. So that should offset the cost as well. And the nice thing as well is our students who have phys ed classes out on the field, instead of having to come back into the building to use the facilities, will be able to use the ones that are right out there, attached to the concession stand.
So, you said that you're going to have the person work in the morning because the facility is going to be used all day long, but this is when the high school students are going to be using it.
So how are you going to break that up?
No, but I mean, this is just for the cleaning, but then you're having that person in there. I mean, you're not having that person in there when the public comes in, but then you're having that person when...
Well, we'll have it cleaned every morning, and there'll be the students at Pennridge there. Come 2, 3, 4, 5, that's when all the rentals start. So from 3 o'clock to 9:30, we have the rentals in. The next morning it'll be cleaned prior to gym class or B class or lacrosse practice, whatever else goes on the other day. the more we review it, the more we see that that field's used from 7:30 in the morning till 9:30 at night, almost every day.
Is there a requirement for staff to be present when outside people are?
Yes, we have, right. And we already have a game manager. Mr. Babb will hire a game manager when there's an outside group that's renting the place, and they have their duties as part of this. If it's just gym class or PE class, and the teachers are up with them during the day.
One of the job duties is assist visitors to the building after school hours in the absence of any other school district personnel, but it's a job that's says 7 a.m. to 11 a.m.
We took the template, the already approved evening custodial job description, and really we only added about 6 or 7, I don't have it in front of me, I'm sorry, line items at the bottom of that, and essential duties, I believe it is. So the first page you're looking at is the template already approved. Which item are you talking about since earlier?
Item three, you're talking about that too, Jeff, or Sean, who's talking about the phone system.
David is going up.
Okay, David.
And Jeff, can you provide where the funds are coming from? Is that from the capital? Just give us some background information.
Yes, we've, in the capital plan, there's been funds available for many years. This has been talked about briefly. Maybe as far back as when the plan was developed 7-8 years ago. Right now we're looking at $500,000 that is in the plan for the future telephone system.
Right, so about 6 months ago we started the conversation to bring it as a conversation. There's no, right now this is just an information for you. We hope that sometime in November timeframe that we will have more specifics so we can bring it to you for a vote. We, today the school district has three separate different types of phone systems. Every building has its own phone system. So today, two of the phone systems, I believe two of them or three of them, they don't make anymore. So the parts are like, it's an issue. When I first started with the district, that was one of the items that was presented to you in the technology committee as a, in the plan. And we're getting close to that, so before Kathy left, we started the conversation that, hey, let's start looking at this and see what we can find. As of today, we went out to a vendor, the CoStar, and we started to ask the questions, how much it, what items will we need, what parts will we need, and we came up with, we did the analysis, we figured out how many lines we have, how many, the whole study on that piece of, what really do we need? And we got a quote, and it's just a quote, but the quote today, which is interesting, is a 17% discount on top of the CoStar discount that we received. So there's a savings there that Kathy and Mr. Dalbert thought that maybe we should start having this conversation because it's a really nice discount.
That's a reason to get it.
And that's all I have for you right now on the project. We feel that it is a necessary product. The product will allow us to bring more information once we get to the point that we know what actual product we're going to have. But it increases the security of the district. It increases the communication of the district. It will be across the board. All the phones will be the same. If a teacher moves from one building to the other, we don't have to hire the phone company to come in and program the phone. The teacher can just go to any phone, log into the phone, and that's her phone, or that's his phone. Same thing with the administration. If, right now, with all the movement, we had to do some programming in the background. With this product, we do the program, we call it the new person, and they can use any of the phones. So we believe that it will increase productivity in that end of the phone and communication side. Any questions?
I have a question. What time frame are you looking at to implement? Like when you're saying to bring it for in November for approval, when are you looking to implement this?
So in talking to the vendor, one of the options that they provide us is a turnkey. They come in, they do the complete installation, and it's done. And they, depending on a couple items, we don't have to take the school down, if you will. We can do this while operations are happening. And with my staff, we can just bring the phone to the desk and plug it in, and it's actually plug it into the network, and it's done on that end. We feel that if we come to the board, to you in November, and let's say that it gets voted in December and we purchase in January, I think that we'll probably be talking late summer that will be completed. The one thing that I'm trying to negotiate and I'm trying to be fair to the vendor is the 17% discount that we received. I'm sure that if I said to them, we're gonna buy next May, that discount is not going to be there. Although at that point, we'll renegotiate that.
Oh, Christ.
That being said, you're saying bring it to the board in November. When do you expect to be able to give us information?
I believe early October. Maybe early October we should have information. One of the items now is that we still have to do a study. We have to find out where the phones are going to go in the classroom. We got to find out what features the teachers want. And when we went out to the vendor, we asked them to give us the best practice. So we can shave from that. We can cut from that. So, and one of the idea that we had, we could buy the equipment now, we can put it in a warehouse and then do it. Well, it's because of that percent, but if the vendor is willing to give us that discount in the future. And what we want to be cautious is with the procurement laws, this is under COSTAR, so we are protected. We want to do it in a way that we save costs and also that it's not a stressful process. Because replacing a phone system could be a very stressful process. You will see more information as we do more research. Thank you very much.
Okay, the final item is the obsolete items for review. And there's by school there, letters A through J. Some things going to public surplus, some things being scrapped. I don't know if there's anything anybody wants to talk about individually there. I guess not.
I do have one question. In this letter B, Sellersville Elementary, why are the pianos in the same lot but then listed separately?
Because I think they're not being scrapped. They're going to public surplus, whereas the other stuff is being scrapped. And I think that's why they're on there. I would assume that's why they're on there twice. they're on the same list, but...
Right, yeah, and the list doesn't say where they're going, so...
I love this one, the reality baby doll.
I know, I love that. It's about to work. She doesn't have it.
All right. All right, so that's it. So any public comment? Oh, lots of public comment, okay.
You go first, Bob.
Let's go first.
Age before beauty.
Robert Linden, West Rock Hill. Could you give me the quantities of laptop computers for each one of those purchases and also the quantity of licenses? You have the dollars down, but I don't have quantities.
So it says here it's 90, the first one is 90 Lenovo's notebooks. Let's see what the second one is. Sorry, I have to keep closing and opening. It's 210 for the elementary, and 32 for the high school art laptops.
And the floating licenses?
The licenses?
Yeah, how many floating licenses?
21.
On the phone system,
Your mic went off. Can you put it back on?
Oh.
There you go.
Regarding the phone system, the proposal, two things. He said, Mr. Toronto said, plug it into the network, so I assume it's an internet protocol phone system and not a hardwired phone system. So if the network goes down, you lose your phone system. Is that correct? Secondly, he said we could buy some equipment and put it in the warehouse. That's just what we want to do, is buy something and put it in a warehouse where it gets obsolete and runs out of warranty.
Sorry.
I think what Mr. Toronto said, sir, was that we don't want to buy the equipment and put it in the warehouse. That's why we're not buying it right now with the 17% discount. We're working with the vendor to have that discount honored later on in the year so that we can purchase it later in the fiscal year and then plan for and have the installation done over next summer.
Well,
yes, that is our goal, is to not to buy it now and put it in a warehouse. So we do agree with what you're saying. Thank you.
Well, the way he came across was buy it and put it in the warehouse.
Ms. Herring, did you want to?
Diane Herring, Hilltown Township. Going back to the Finance Committee, item seven, we used to get the dollar amounts for SAC accounts. We no longer seem to get those published anywhere. And as far as I can tell, not in one Finance Committee meeting this year were any of the quarterly reports discussed. Am I mistaken in that?
We received the quarterly reports as part of the overall finances, you know, the personnel. What is that called? Yeah, but I mean that whole agenda where we make one big approval at the beginning of every board meeting. The quarterly, actually they're monthly. All the student activity accounts are in there and we're approving them.
Okay. Is there any way to publicly access them? It is student money.
We provided this amount to board, but we never provided to public. I don't know if board will decide we can include amounts too. So it's up to board.
Yeah, I guess they are public, right? Once we.
It's no problem for us to do this because I keep track.
They're public records. They're certainly subject to the right to know law, so they could be requested by someone through the right to know law. And the district wouldn't be violating any law by affirmatively publishing them on a regular basis.
So from now on, we will include this amount.
It's up to the board. It can do either, but the bottom line is the board can make the information public. It's obligated to make it public, probably in response to a right to know request, but there's nothing that prevents it from posting it or making it otherwise public.
Okay.
Thank you. As it relates to item two and the custodial staff, if I understood Mr. Loeffler correctly, he said the position was going to be for 5 days per week, and per Mrs. Yardley's comments, it was to run from 7 a.m. to 11 a.m., if I understand that correctly. Is that correct?
I think it's wrong.
That's right, yes.
Okay, well, the only reason I caught on to that is knowing that what days of the week were you planning those 5 days of the week being? Monday through Friday?
Monday through Friday.
Then what happens on Saturday morning after a home football game that ran till 10 o'clock at night?
That's on there also, that this gentleman or person would work that Saturday morning also.
Okay, so it's above and beyond the 20 hours you're projecting, so is
just
all of that statistically calculated into the total expected cost of what their annual salary would be?
I based the salary on 5 days a week.
So then we haven't financially accounted for that extra day then, and typically we go from anywhere between 4 and 6 home games, correct?
Correct. We also have our regular custodial crew that will be helping out on those games as we did at South. We'll do the same thing here.
Okay, so I'm just trying to understand the number. If it's missing a component because you talked about 5 days a week and kind of a personal experience being up here till 10:30, 11 o'clock on a Friday night regular basis when there's a home game.
We have a separate overtime budget for the department.
Okay, great.
So what would need to be transferred would need to be, and found within the budget, would need to be the regular wages. The overtime will come out of it's already budgeted.
Okay. On a note regarding Questech and getting more help, just a personal observation from a parent's perspective of technology right now, the school district's website's been down for about 6 hours right now. So I went tonight to look for clarification on whether tonight's meeting started at 6:30 or 7 or 7:30 because we keep waffling. And the only reason I was able to actually nail it down is because I have actively and proactively subscribed to get those emails that you send with board agenda updates. I find the technology lately to be exceptionally difficult to manage as a parent. PowerSchool, it's whatever teacher is current versus those teachers that aren't. There were numerous days this past year where the system went offline in this building and both of my kids went hours without instruction. Specifically my daughter, who is in the humanities program, which is completely governed by laptop, and went hours without organizational time, teaching time, everything. When this entire technology initiative was discussed, and I sat through those meetings 3-4 years ago, we were told time and time and time again about 24/7 assistance, redundancy built in, all these other things, yet they don't seem to happen when it comes to actually day-to-day occurrences. And I just hope that if we're going to go with a voice over IP phone system, which it sounds like, then we're talking about buying more software that's web-based and all these other things, we actually sit down and have a constructive discussion on what our redundancy systems are.